like, this is very informal, so feel free to raise your hand or just, you know, point at us. Hi, I'm Tara from the Human Impacts Institute, and I'm here with Geneva and Phil, and we're at the Brooklyn Art Library here, wonderful space, and Stephen, maybe today we'll even get a little spiel from you about the space for everyone, because I know not everyone's seen your fabulous BuzzFeed video. and we also have a little one here, so you might see a baby throughout this impact hour. She's our academic for the day. And today we're going to talk about sustaining effective action. And this was a theme that we thought about, particularly with this year, post-elections. We've noticed, you know, there are a lot of new people to activism or to, you know, that are maybe finding their voice in terms of getting involved in different ways. And for many people who have been in environmental work or social justice work or just, you know, this type of work, kind of social change work, as we sometimes call it, you know, we've learned a lot of lessons about maybe burnout, you know, both just personal burnout, but even organizational burnout, learned about, you know, how do we know when we're making a difference in the work we do, because it's not always obvious. And so that's why we decided this would be an exciting theme. And before I go much further, I'd love for you guys, in your own voices, to maybe introduce where you're coming from, and particularly Phil. I know you're shifting where you're going right now, so maybe we'll start with you, Phil, and give you a second.
Sure. Hi, everybody. My name is Phil Arignano, and I've been organizing and campaigning since I was 15, so it's almost 20 years ago. Seems like it was yesterday. And I've spent most of that time, about 10 years of that time, and plus some, working on the issue of climate change. Helped coordinate and co-found an organization called 350.org, which is a global organization that works on climate change.
She's like, shout out.
She's like, I don't care about 350. It's milk. Good, important grounding. Comment.
Yeah, please feel free to comment at any time, both in person and on Facebook. If you're watching on Facebook Live, we have Natasha who's looking for questions.
Of course, happy to answer your questions. And spent the last year and a half since leaving 350 working on political campaigns and doing a bunch of work with the sort of burgeoning resistance movement, in particular the Women's March and People's Climate March. So that's what I've been working on. And I just left the consulting company that I was working at and going out on my own, lots of different projects. So
great.
That's my work life.
Maybe we'll get to hear about some of those as well. And Geneva, please tell us a little bit more about yourself.
I am a creative and documentary filmmaker. Canadian American, and I've lived in the States for about 7 years and spent a great deal of time growing up in the arts. My mom was very politically active and always was very inspired by her work and what she did and how she really used her voice to kind of help create a platform or help other people have a voice. And more recently, I've kind of decided in my own way to take that. But I spent a long time definitely being support staff, production companies, being a production office manager, and that kind of thing, and kind of learning from my environment. And then a few years ago, decided to share a story, or be a part of sharing a story of a really incredible young girl named Emma Zitcher-Long. And she's one of the most incredible people I've ever met in my life. And she co-directed a film that we all just finished called Unspoken. Her story, and it was a really important project to be a part of because it's basically giving the voice to people who have been spoken on behalf by other people. And so Emma is a young girl who has autism, and she has full control of the narrative of the film and her voice, and it was a beautiful eye-opening experience. And I've decided that that's definitely the way I want to continue my work in my life, is seeing how I can support people in creating a platform to make sure that they're heard and that it's not about me, and how can I maybe possibly help that, you know, help them have that platform and put it out there. So I'm kind of on that journey right now.
Wonderful. Exciting. And thank you to both of you. Sorry for a little noises here. For being here this morning. And I think a great place to start the conversation, we've done it a little bit in the teaser video that Phil answered a question, is kind of setting what do we mean by effectiveness? And because that could take on so many different versions or thoughts depending on what aspect of our life we're talking about. But maybe even particularly in the work that you do, how do you define effectiveness for yourself? And maybe Geneva will come to you since Phil gave us a little teaser earlier.
It's interesting because I kind of look at effectiveness in so many different ways. And to me, I think right now in my life, the way I look at effectiveness is making sure that it's aligned with my initial goal or whatever, especially because effectiveness for a project. It's aligned with what I started out with the idea being, and then of course it kind of grows, and what you want the social aspect to be. And it could be small, it could be a larger scale, but effectiveness can also be impacting one person's life. Mm. You know, and now I'm kind of looking at it completely differently, because before I was like, effectiveness has to be like big social change, or it has to be like really like massive. And I'm really realizing the power of how effective it can be when you can just create a small ripple, and then that ripple becomes bigger when you create change in one person's life, and it kind of like they create change in someone else's and someone else's, and it's kind of like it keeps kind of going and gets bigger.
Yeah, and there's something beautiful in that, I think, as well, that I've thought about a lot in my work and kind of my journey of getting here is trying to figure out where you feel most comfortable or most, you know, kind of your role in the bigger picture of whether it's social change or, you know, sparking action, which is stuff that we talk a lot about. It's like, where do I think I personally and the things that I value in my life and the person of who I am can be, you know, quote unquote, most effective or empowering, you know, to others or and also, where do I want to be? Because not everyone wants to be speaking in front of a bunch of people. Like, you like being behind the camera. But knowing that, there's something powerful in knowing that as well. And Phil, you talked a little bit on the teaser about kind of what I very succinctly called a really interesting view on life-work balance or intersection. Can you rehash that a little bit for us?
Sure. I was actually thinking what you're saying. Maybe I could kind of circle around
to
that.
For it.
You know, I think I've been really struggling with this idea of effectiveness, actually, in my work. You know, I spent 15 years basically doing big street mobilizations, starting with big days of action before the Copenhagen climate talks in 2008 and 2009, which put, you know, tens of thousands of, or hundreds of thousands of people in the streets around the world, to the People's Climate March here in New York in 2014, which was like almost 500,000 people, to the Women's March, which I worked on, which was 5 million people around the world. It always felt like there was some, you know, endpoint that it almost felt like there was a North Star that I was moving towards, this idea that if we could just get more people in the streets, more people involved in that particular way, using that particular tactic, that it would be really effective. And I think that since November in particular, since the election, I feel like I've been really reevaluating what I thought I knew about effectiveness and political change, and thinking a lot about the different avenues, whether they're cultural or really interpersonal, or really dealing with art and sort of a deeper engagement with each person. And so I'm kind of in the middle of that journey of figuring out for myself, what I feel is most effective and therefore most fulfilling for me. Because I'm the kind of guy who really wants to spend my time on the thing that's going to be most effective. I don't want to spend months putting 500,000 people in the streets and then get nothing out of it. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody wants that. So in that sense, I think the personal and the sort of political and the broader context and how those trajectories are flowing really matters, because if I'm sitting there doing work that isn't fulfilling to me and also doesn't particularly impact the world, then that's not really helping anybody. But if in some moment of time my skills and what I can bring to the table and what I consider fulfilling is useful in the broader context of movement for whatever, a year, 6 months, 3 months, 10 years, whatever, then I feel like that's when I know I've felt deep down a sense of effectiveness, both personally, and the work that I've put out in the world has also been most effective.
Hmm. Yeah, and I think that's really important to hear, particularly from people like both of you, who externally, I think a lot of people would view the output of your work and your careers as like, oh my God, you guys are making a huge difference. You're doing like, you get what? You get 500,000 people in the street? What? You produce an entire film and you're getting all these people, you know, working with so many diverse people. I think externally there can be a sense of effectiveness that can be very different internally. And I think particularly that's a really important thing to share, particularly for people who might be new to this type of work, where, I mean, when we're talking about something like climate change or on helping, share voices that aren't being heard, there can be very small wins at times. And I think that's something I'd like to shift the next one. I think sometimes, particularly with people that are doing such amazing work, it can be really powerful for people to hear some of the kind of times where you feel like you've fallen on your face a little bit and not been so effective. So I'm wondering if you're willing to be vulnerable this morning. I know, I'm starting hardcore, right? Your worst nightmares come true. to share maybe some spaces where you've been like, wow, I was not effective in that, and I learned this from that experience. You have shared one earlier with me.
Yeah, I kind of feel like I've had many, you know, and I embrace those experiences because they're life lessons. You get back up. You know, you fall on your face, you get back up. You fall on your face again, dust yourself up, get back up. And there's always a lesson that's to be learned. It's not always easy. It's sometimes really hard, and you have to kind of step back and also realize, you know, there's sometimes ego. Like, you know what I mean? Like, ego is your biggest enemy. Hmm. It holds you back from so much growth. So,
and can you tell me what you mean by that? Do you have maybe an example?
I'm trying to think, because there's like so many. Like, this whole hour could be about it. But I think one of the things that was the most challenging but also at the same time most rewarding is taking on a project, first of all, that is so personal. This film, Unspoken, is so personal for me because I've known Emma since she was 8. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's that personal connection. She's like a little sister to me. And then also, she co-directed it, and then my best friend, Julia, who's an amazing filmmaker as well. She co-directed it and did the cinematography. So the three of us came together. And what is challenging is collaboration is challenging, mm-hmm. right? You know, because I think that gets transferred into not just like in an art project, like a film or whatever, but that goes into like community, that goes into politics. And you have to create a space and remind yourself to constantly have an open space where you're all being. It's not about you speaking all the time. And that's not where power comes from. especially, you know, political. I always think about that. People really think about, like, you know, they don't want to hand over power and, like, them speaking and being the ones telling everybody else, you know, what's right for them.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much more power when you sit back and you listen.
And
so it's understanding that and not allowing, you know, your ego to get in the way or wanting things to go your way or that kind of thing. It's like something becomes so much more powerful and more beautiful when you're all heard and you all add to that project or whatever it might be. Even in society, you know,
yeah.
If we had like, I'm kind of like moving towards that, you know. But that it's been a 3-year process, and you know, things come up along the way, and you have to have hard discussions and real discussions, and be open and not take things too seriously. And at the end of the day, lead with love. You know what I mean? Like, I got it.
It's all right.
Got
embrace,
a tattooed on my wrist. Like, lead with love.
And I feel like I bet you have a lot to say, and I'm gonna kind of lead you somewhere, and then let you circle around again if you want to. Because I very much personally agree with everything you're saying, but in a practical sense, at times, the more people in the room, the more voices, the more voices. You know, it can, in terms of this effectiveness, it both is very effective in terms of you're truly building community, things like this, but sometimes it can also be you have 50 people in the room, they're 50 different opinions, they're 50 different or 100 different ways to move forward. So it can also be hard. It can also make it hard to, quote, get something done if that's something you're trying to do as well. So Phil, I wonder if you have any idea, and I'd love you to push back on that as well. I'm just throwing that out as an idea. Do you have any thoughts on that, or also on what Geneva said?
Yeah, I mean, I think the ego piece is exactly right. I mean, I think that when you're talking about leadership, when you're talking about collaboration, it really is about people, about their desires and their needs and what they're projecting, both what they're projecting out, but also what they're, you know, what's in the back of their head and what they're feeling. And I think the most effective leaders out there don't completely submerge their egos, but they recognize how to use them most effectively and in which moments, and when to like lead by planting a flag and saying, this is what we're gonna do, and like, y'all gotta come along, and when to say, actually, we're all gonna work on this together, we're gonna talk about it for an hour or 5 hours or 5 months, depending on what the thing is. I think a strong leader is somebody who knows when to sort of, how to have that dance, basically. When to push forward and really step out and say, we're gonna do this thing, and when to say, actually, I'm gonna listen. Talk to themselves and facilitate that and actually like draw out some of that. There have been, you know, I've had a million different meetings that have gone badly. I can't think of one that's still traumatic to me. There is one that's really traumatic to me that happened over a year ago. I'll tell you about it because I think it's like instructive. So I was state director for the Burn campaign here in New York, a job which came to me kind of randomly via a bunch of different connections. And I landed on the ground here. I was hired basically 8 weeks before the primary. So we had zero staff and zero budget 8 weeks before the primary. And then over the course of 8 weeks, like, you know, hundreds of staff from other states rolled in who didn't know anything about New York. We like, so many things happened, it really felt like a tidal wave. I won't go into all of that. But one thing that the Burning campaign didn't have, they had a great sort of like faith outreach operation that was really focused on like the Muslim community and was focused on the Christian community and was focused on a few different, but they had like zero Jewish organizing infrastructure. And being like one of just a few Jewish people on the campaign other than the senator himself. I was like, you can't organize New York without directly addressing Jewish folks here because there's a lot of them. It's like 10% of the city or something, and a big chunk of the electorate. And I think they were up for grabs because sometimes they vote Republican, sometimes they vote Democrat. And so I organized, I thought, I know the Jewish community like pretty well. Like I haven't really gone to Temple that much. I don't know it that well, but I know it enough to sort of like organize a Jews for Bernie event. So last minute, thrown together like 3 weeks before the primary, I pulled together this Jews for Bernie event. We sent it out to our email list and like hundreds of people signed up. And I pulled together some different surrogates who I felt like would represent different parts of the Jewish community. And we show up to this union hall that we had rented. And I realized right away that every single person, almost every single person there who had signed up to come, came to basically like harass me about Bernie's policy on Israel. I like totally misread the situation. It was my mistake. Like it was, I thought that because I was Jewish, that I could sort of like hold an organizing meeting where everybody would be psyched about Bernie and we'd get people to start knocking doors or make phone calls or donate money. And what it turned into was this like barrage of just like people yelling at me. I was like, I don't set Bernie's policy positions and I'm just here to sort of facilitate you all. So in that context, what I thought was gonna be more of like a collaborative organizing meeting, I should have known ahead of time or read the cards right and better understood the community to realize that it wasn't going to be that. It was going to be people who wanted their voices heard and wanted Bernie to hear them. And I was just like the conduit in that context. So that was like, and I had like, you know, traumatizing dreams about that meeting for like months afterwards.
I think we've all had those in the line of work we do.
But I think it's just an example of where like, I had a big blind spot as to what the Jewish community here, even though I'm part of the Jewish community, like I didn't do my homework and actually like do the one-on-ones with people in that community and better understand where folks were at. And I also set up a situation in which people were looking to me as sort of like the guy in charge. And I could have set that up also really differently. So it's just sort of an interesting experience that was also somewhat traumatizing.
And sometimes we learn the most from those. And I think that comes back also to your great point about ego. I've certainly experienced a lot in our work that I often have to let go of what I thought was going to happen. You know, whether it's a workshop or, you know, an event or, you know, an action, anything, just in life in general, but particularly in our work, that when you're working with other people, sometimes it's just what you envisioned and what everyone agreed upon before a meeting is not what's going to happen. And I've learned that giving into that, really amazing stuff often comes. Because, you know, we have as an organization set up an infrastructure, set up, you know, this idea, but then we let people make it their own. And I feel like that's much stronger than anything we could create on our own. And I think that comes to something that you had talked about with collaboration as well. And I'm wondering if we can touch a little bit on, I feel like now might be a good time, for one, to see if there are any questions. But before we get to that, so think of questions, both online and in person. But this idea of, so now that we have this, you know, I've talked a little bit about effectiveness and how we've gotten there and how we haven't gotten there in some cases, keeping it going. Because being effective once or twice, like we all can do that. But really trying to maintain, I feel like, for me, is one of the hardest things. Particularly because when we're working on climate change, it's like a couple inches forward and a few steps back often. And sometimes it's big wins, and then the wins are reversed, you know, and it's just, it's definitely an emotional roller coaster. And so I'm wondering, how have you personally dealt with this idea of being able to keep going in the work you're doing in a healthy way? And if you, yeah, if you have ideas to share with people.
Yeah, I do. It's definitely been a struggle. And I think because I'm so emotionally invested in the project or anything that I really have decided to move forward with in other projects that are about creating voices, is that there's this feel of personal responsibility. And that is a excuse me, a blessing, but it's also a curse. And I'm still learning to try to find that balance, because understanding also that the weight of what you're doing isn't just on you, it's on other people as well. You know, like, it's, instead of carrying all the weight of it on your shoulders, being like, I must do this, but, you know, it's like this project Unspoken, you know, we're really setting out to change the dialogue around autism and judgment as a whole, and really pushing for self-advocacy and the importance of that. And, you know, there's times where I've definitely burned out because I'm like, must change the dialogue, must change the world, gotta keep going, you know. And just working on it countless hours throughout the day and not really realizing that self-care is extremely important. You know, so you can't be effective if you can't take care of yourself. So I think, first of all, you really need to, like, make sure that you understand that balance of taking care of yourself and being able to have the energy and clarity to move forward. And then also realizing you can't do it on your own, and effectively creating change means also creating community. You know?
And that comes to the collaboration.
It comes back to collaboration, yeah. Whether it's in small groups or whether it's, you know, larger as well.
I've found one of the hardest things for me to learn, and this is probably also about very much about my personality, is, and I don't know if my colleagues agree with me or not, is it is hard for me to ask for help. And I do ask for help, but it is a hard thing. I am a person that likes to do things, you know, I like to create and make things, and it can be hard when I know that, A, I'm not the best person to do a certain job, that again comes to the ego, that's really hard for me to be like, I'm not the best messenger, or, but to really truly ask others and say, listen, I need you to step up here, or whatever. And Phil, what do you think in terms of, as we dance to the phone?
Yeah, I don't know. I've never really experienced, I think, burnout in the way that a lot of, I think, activists experience burnout. Like, total, just sort of like, you know, I was just on the campaign for 10 months and now I'm going to sleep for like 5 months, you know? I think a lot of people get there. And I've never really had that. I don't know why. I think it's like genetic or something. But I definitely have experienced a lot of frustration, and I've heard a lot of people, including people that I've worked with for a long time, reach that burnout stage. And I think everybody's different, but one of the things that I'm learning now as I'm sort of transitioning out from sort of running campaigns, like, all, you know, day-to-day campaigns, and trying to pin into more of a consultation and advisory role, is that I think the people who have, when I look at my heroes, people like Heather Booth and John Lewis and others who, John Lewis is a representative from Georgia who has helped start SNCC, which was the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in the Civil Rights Movement, and then has been an activist and organizer for his whole life. And Heather Booth is also was part of SNCC. An older white woman who also went on to run a bunch of political campaigns and has started a bunch of training programs and things like that for progressives, and is still doing stuff. She's like 78 or something, and is really, there's actually a movie about her called Heather Booth that just came out. I definitely recommend checking that out. When I look at people like that, I think there's like a few identifying factors. I'm sure they probably had their burnout phase, whatever, but largely they've been consistent in their work. One is that they're always pushing themselves and challenging themselves and learning. Like, they never get complacent with the work that they're doing, so that they're constantly sort of like feeding their curiosity and feeding their energy by interacting with different people and different ideas. Not just talking to the same people, doing the same thing every day. Two is they surround themselves with people who like really love and support them, and also understand their commitment to the movement. Like all the friends that I made in the climate movement that I can call on at any moment and ask them for advice, I think that's like that support network is kind of like a safety net. And I use that all the time now, even though I'm not like at a climate organization. And then I think a third thing that I've been thinking about a lot, because I think people get to a place where they've been doing the thing that they love for a long time, whether it's making films or doing organizing and campaigning, and they're like, all right, I learned a lot of stuff here. I'm kind of like in a, I've been doing this for a long time, I know what I'm doing. You sort of, at least I found in myself, I've transitioned from trying to push the envelope on the sort of like external outputs of the work, even though I want to win lots of things all the time, still. But recognizing that a lot of what's holding me back from doing better work externally is my my inner mindfulness and the way that I approach my own life and the way that I focus my own work. And so I've really dived into like my own mindfulness practice in the pursuit of becoming like the ninja of my own life, you know, just like really focusing in and trying to make my own like mental processes and habits that I sort of developed organically more efficient and effective, so that I can approach the work and my leadership externally more effectively. And so that's, I think, for me, where the connection between the personal and the work that I do and sustaining myself in that work happens.
Yeah, and I think that very much mirrors what you said, Geneva, in terms of like self-care, the words you had used. And I very much agree in what it, and thank you for sharing, for one. But the idea of if we're not individually strong, then we're not doing our best work either. You know, would be one version that I would say for myself. When I'm run down or get sick or too tired or any of the human things that we all experience, I'm not going to be my most effective, or I'm not going to listen well in that space. And she doesn't help sometimes with that, the sleep part, but... I wanted to see, before we go on, if there are any questions either online, if there are any Facebook questions, or in the room, if any of you have any questions. Comment. Yeah.
So I'm trying to do my best from my personal practice as a designer. And I was wondering how you get to inspire more people to take that that inspiration and that challenge to take action in their own communities and their families. Like, do you get it more personal, even though climate change sounds so big? How you get it more a personal and a day-by-day issue for getting people to change small actions and small things in their life?
I'll let you get Phil. Do you want to start with that one?
Sure, yeah. I mean, I think the best way to start is to just, you know, pull your friends together who you have some connection with, who have, like, different kinds of expertise, but sort of common language. You know, grab a beer or grab dinner and talk about what, you know, come up with, brainstorm some ideas, put up some post-its, right? And then This is like the classic organizer, right?
You post-its.
Post-its on the wall, you know, vote on the ones you want to do, and then try to move one of those ideas forward. And maybe you'll find out that somebody else has already started doing that. You can join their work. Or maybe it's something nobody else has thought of. Or somebody else has thought of but hasn't been operating effectively. But I think that's how we started 350, the organization that that I worked for many years, is like we were sitting around at dinner and we were like, you know, what the climate movement needs is actually a movement, like a social movement, not just like scientists talking about the facts. And it grew from there. So I think that kind of creativity, especially from folks who have maybe like one foot in the political space and one foot out, is really important. My wife is a clown and an actor, and I'm constantly feeding her ideas to just get feedback, because I spend all my time talking to political people, and you hear the same things back from, you know, that's a great idea, that's a bad idea, somebody's already doing that. But I think she brings a really fresh perspective almost always. Mm-hmm. She's like, that sounds like a really interesting, or that's stupid, you know?
People closest to you.
Yeah, people closest to me. So, yeah, that's how I would go about doing it.
Yeah. Any thoughts?
I love the idea of collaboration. So, reaching out to friends, community, and really finding out what's needed and what people want, making sure everyone's heard, and whatever in that kind of situation resonates the most within you and that you're most passionate about, you follow through with. And even if it's just like one person at a time, again, it's about that, for me anyways, it's always about that emotional connection. Hmm. And that can be extremely, extremely powerful and effective and create a much larger.
And I would say, I mean, our work in particular, where we're taking the organization in our next phase, is really working with artists and creatives to help spark change and to help connect people to solutions in creative ways, to get more clowns working on climate. We actually have a board member who is like a policy person and then also secretly a clown. I won't reveal who they are, but I love that. And a couple of things that we've found really resonate is the idea of like Phil had touched on, you're most impactful in your inner circle. That's where trust already exists. That's where common languages exist, some shared experience exists. So we have a lot, it's also sometimes the hardest place to go because you're invested. Like me talking to my neighbors is much harder than talking to 1,000 strangers. Because it's part of my life. I can't escape it in a way. If it goes wrong, I'm living it every day. But there's a lot of, you already have a great spot there in your circle of influence, as it were. And then I would say also creatively as a designer, I love the idea of again, starting with listening and hearing, what do your friends want? Say, hey, like, what do you think about climate change? Is there something you've kind of always wished you could take part in or have always wondered about? And then that's a great starting point as well. Never undervalue just how inspiration is so important. And as a creative, that's kind of your expertise, is inspiring people with your work. And I personally think that's been something that has been lacking a lot in the environmental movement and climate movement. As a general sweeping statement, there's a lot of beautiful inspiration throughout, but we could definitely use more of that. And I would argue that's true with any just tough topic, whether you're talking about autism or human rights atrocities or climate change, it's hard to want to talk about that stuff all the time and to want to face it. So I think inspiration and using your design in that way is really powerful.
Yeah, and I
and going back to the idea of like getting some friends together, the last few projects that I've worked on one of them started off as just me by myself at home with a bunch of, like, how I work is I put just like white sheets of paper everywhere and I take a black Sharpie and I write an idea down, and then from that idea I write down words, and so much inspiration starts coming to me, and then I can organize it and it becomes like a full-fledged concept. And then like that for me is really fun and exciting, and I ignite inspiration myself, but then also others, you know. I choose to then like bring other people on board, but it's also way more fun and exciting when you have some friends over and you do like a brainstorming session. Maybe you have a group of friends and you decide, you know, we're all working full time, but how do we find that balance where we're working full time, but then we also have this creative outlet, which is so important to have. Mm-hmm. And you can make time for it. You know, it might mean that you're not going to get that much sleep, but you know, if you together all decide to commit, you know, we want to work on a long-term project and we can commit, you know, a certain amount of hours every week, and this is what we want the outcome to be, you can do that, you know. Or it might be you want to tackle, depending what kind of design project it is, maybe within every month as a group, you guys are making a project every month, you know, and that also, you grow as a creative then, adds to your portfolio, and then, you know, you're collaborating with other people and you're all learning and growing together, and it's so exciting.
And then I want to add another and then see if there are other questions, and then I also have a final question. We have about 15 minutes left.
Hi, welcome.
All right, I think you're going straight through, yeah. Right? Well, welcome anyways. I found that it's really exciting to help people see that they can make a difference no matter what their expertise is. And that they can often, almost always, use their expertise or their interests, or if they don't think they have an expertise or talents, their interests at least, for, you know, fill in the blank issue. And I often use the idea of, if you're an accountant, you can help an awful lot on climate change, because there are all of these small organizations that have horrible bookkeeping, and in order to keep their work going, they need to know how to, you know, do financial management. Like,
guilty.
Yeah, see? Yeah. So I love this idea of people giving in their way. Like, we're not necessarily going to make you into like a water data specialist, you know, mm-hmm. where you're out, you know, testing fecal coliform type, you know, big words. But that as a filmmaker, if you want to use that skill, you can really make a difference. Other questions here, or are there any Facebook questions at all? No Facebook questions.
I wanted to add something
kind of
to that too, is that also be very open-minded to different people and different ideas. You know, I think like it's interesting how we put value of people based on their level of education, their the amount of money they make, where they come from, mm-hmm. Their cultural background, their age. And that needs to be erased.
Mm.
You know, that limits you from growing and connecting with other people and also creating. You know, some of the greatest ideas that you're going to come up with someone else can be someone completely different than you, that you had, you might have thought something differently of them, you know? And that's beautiful. Like, just don't hold yourself back and don't allow the perceptions to hold you back. You'll be so pleasantly surprised by like the beauty and like the value, the same value that we all have and what we can all bring to the table. It's something that I've personally experienced a lot as I'm getting older. I'm in my like late 30s, and I'm a woman, and I'm a woman of color. You know, I've experienced a lot of judgment throughout my life, and you know, instead of holding on to that, I choose to look forward openly, you know, and it's such a more beautiful place when you do that.
I love that idea of letting go of assumptions of who's an expert, because we're all experts in our own lives and in what we've been through, and I love that. And that comes back, I think, to that listening, too, and being open to finding things in many different places. So we only have a few more minutes, but I wanted to, this is something that's very hard and I think important to me in terms of this idea of sustaining effectiveness, and feel free to be like, it's not important to you. So we can see, but this idea of prioritization. For me, I mean, I think my colleagues know I always have these like crazy lists of a million different things going on, and you know, oftentimes there are many things that feel like a five-alarm fire, and that can be in personal life, but also in terms of movements. You know, if anyone looks at the news ever or on Twitter, you know, it feels like, oh my God, I need to act on that and that and that. So I'm wondering if you have examples, either from your own lives or from you've seen from others, of this idea of how on earth do we prioritize when there's just so much going on? Deep thoughts in the morning.
I've been thinking a lot about the sort of growing resistance movement. And because I was involved with the Women's March, I have all this like kind of interesting data that we collected about who marched and their level of experience and that kind of how many voted. We have a lot of that information, that data, and it's really kind of informed / changed the way that I've been thinking about activism. So for a long time, you know, I think those of us who've been working on the left sort of flank of the progressive politics kind of were operating under a sense of scarcity. Like, there were only a certain number of people who were going to take time out of their regular everyday lives to march or call or post on Facebook or whatever. And we wanted to leverage those people to impact decision makers, whether it was President Obama or Congress or whatever. And we did that fairly effectively. But what we didn't take into account was there's all these people out there who agree with us who weren't really doing anything, right? Who are living their lives, and you know, maybe they canvassed for President Obama in 2008 or 2007. Maybe they made some phone calls, and then he got elected, and they kind of like, they were like, great, done.
We did it.
We elected a black guy to president. Like, it's all good. Like, we fixed it. And I think that's, you know, the thing that we saw in January around the Women's March was that I think tons of people woke up, like woke back up or whatever. And there were lots of new people also who were never involved before. Something like 30% of the people who marched the Women's March had never marched before, period. And 60% hadn't marched in over 5 years. Most of them voted. Most of them were women between the ages of 40 and 70, white women between the ages of 40 and 70. And this is a demographic and a set of people who I think we have an opportunity at every level, from the national level to the community level, to engage in really meaningful ways. And figuring out how to do that, I think, and sustain that is really critical. And I really do believe that sort of the outrage machine, right, the thing that we get every day on our social media feed and in the news, like, oh my God, Trump did the thing, like, we need to respond, is just fundamentally not sustainable, right? It's like, we know from human behavioral studies that that sort of just, like, emergency response, like, that's what leads to burnout over the course of time. So, we have a big challenge ahead of us, which is that we have all these new people, or people who are re-engaged after many years of not being engaged in politics. And we need to figure out how to sustain that, not just on like a me as Phil, Rio as Geneva, Rio as Tara, but like on the mass scale, right? This is 5 million people who got out in the streets.
I don't know. Like, listen, I'm ready.
Yeah, they're like, we're like, ready to go.
Yeah.
And I think this is a challenge to those of us who do public communication, who do organizing, to figure out new and innovative ways to keep that sustained. And the truth is, like, the ways that we've been doing that for the past 5 to 8 years, or 10 years, however long I've been involved with the political stuff, in that sort of like scarcity zone where we've never had quite enough people to like make impact, is we have to look at it from a different lens now. It's a different moment. So I'm personally committed to really try to widen my lens and understand better the way that artists and communicators and cultural ambassadors and musicians and other folks and activists in the past have taken advantage of these particular kinds of moments and use different tools to engage people, whether it's film or whatever.
You're hired, Phil. Come on over. You've always wanted to be HIA.
Yes.
Thank you. I think that's I love hearing that through the data too. I think that's really interesting and important. But that idea that we're just dealing with a different issue right now, in the sense of so many people wanting something. And I think we're often, like you had said, we're often not ready for that. I've noticed that a lot in terms of even creative outlets about issues. It's almost always about the problem. Like community films, environmental films are pretty much always trying to get you to care. But then once you care, it's kind of like, oh, now what? So the idea of let's start focusing on really helping people take action is exciting. What do you think?
I think it's really difficult in, I guess, like today's day and age, with all these things coming at you, especially socially at the top, like at once, you know, with what's going on in the news, it's overwhelming. And it's really hard not to get emotionally invested and distracted and angry.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also really important to step back and to really shut out that noise, and that's what it is, and be very aware of what's going on in the world, but also not internalizing it. And realizing, like, staying focused on the path that you're on and what you're doing, you know, and making sure that you're fully aware and reminded of where you're going and what you want to do. Because everything that's happening around you seems to be, in many ways, falling apart, you know? And how can you be a part of bringing it back together is a challenge, but it's really important. So you kind of have to have that, you kind of have to build almost like a cocoon. And I'm not saying that you need to not be aware of what's going on around you, because you absolutely should be. But do not internalize it, you know, kind of like, of course, mobilize and organize in that, but and stay focused and just keep pushing forward, you know, like keep your like eye on the prize and just keep going. There's going to be distractions every step of the way, you know, hurdles and everything. It's just like, keep going.
Can I have one more thing?
Of course, yeah. Sorry. We have about 5 more minutes.
Cool, I'll be quick. I think the one thing that I've been experimenting with is like also understanding that as time goes on and through different moments, like you play different roles. Like, you know, I was deeply involved in like helping lead a lot of the outreach to sister marches for the Women's March. So that was like 3 or 4 months of just like sprinting.
Mm.
And now I'm back in a role where I'm much more in an advisory capacity and helping other organizers and activists take leadership in a way. And I think recognizing that there are those cycles also at the personal level is actually really critical. Sometimes you might be able to convene your friends who are designers and like do the thing and lead the charge and you have all that energy. And then you might also think about how you're sort of like setting yourself up for somebody else in your crew 3 months later or 5 months later to really take that on. So you're always sort of like looking to where the ball is going to be, not just to where it is right now.
That's great. Yeah.
And I think too, also while you're just kind of going back to what I was saying, like keep your eye on the prize and like what it is you're doing is very important. But at the same time, in what's going on in the world, seeing how you can be a part of like how can you be of service? You know what I mean? And like making sure that you're being a part of a team and helping out as well.
And checking in with that, I think that
you know, that we change as individuals of what we want to do, and that comes back to some of your mentors, Phil, of they shifted. They didn't always do the same thing in order to keep going, that sometimes that might be shifting from day to day or month to month or year to year or shifting careers at some point. I would like to add also in terms of prioritization, I need wins sometimes. So I think setting myself up for wins, no matter how small they might be sometimes, just so the emotional side of it for me, I mean, I live this work and I always have and I feel like I always will, but I do get not the 5 months of burnout, but I do get like the 3 days of Netflix burnout, which I think we probably all do with life in general, but I find that's really important in terms of the prioritization. For one, acknowledging I'm just not going to get everything done that I wanted to get done, and all the projects that we thought were going to happen, some of them are going to, you know, burn and crash, and some just aren't going to happen for a couple years, or ever maybe. But that idea of if there's any way to give myself those little successes, and for me, like, I'll just give a concrete example. One of the programs that we have is called Trees and Tutus, and we really keep that. It's about like stewardship and culture together. We go and we care. We get people to come and care for trees in a park, and then we have like a cultural performance. And it just feels like, yeah, you love them. It feels like such a little win, because gardening, you immediately see the impact of your action. People are happy and smiley the whole time and just thanking you. And then you just like, you enjoy a wonderful, you know, work of culture, of local culture. And so that, you know, even though we might not be making a huge impact, we weed one area of a park in New York City, that gives me a huge win. And I also feel like it's one of our best community building, local community building things that we have. I wanted to share that because I feel like that's an important one for me. Any closing thoughts, guys? And thank you so much. This has been really interesting. And thanks for adding. Any last thoughts that you want to share? Are there any last questions while you're thinking from the audience? Online or in person? Do you have one today? No? Mackenzie,
oh,
your
Lord.
Last day.
I'm so focused on the live stream.
No.
Change can be on any scale. It can be creating change in your home, on your block, in your community, in your city. It could be your country. It could be any level. Every single one of those matters, and it adds to a larger movement. So don't ever doubt yourself. Just know that you can do it, and just start.
Yeah, the first step is often, the second step's a lot easier. The first can be scary. Well, thank you so much, guys. It's exciting. And thank you to everyone here and online and future viewers of this. Our next one is, what's the official date?
September 21st.
September 21st. And the location is to be determined. And that will be a conversation about collaboration across borders. So this idea of talking about being an ally, and what does that really look like? You know, how do we actually put that into action? So thank you guys so much. This was lovely.
Thank you.
Nice to see you.
Bye.
Well done. You made it.
Do last thoughts, Zoe.
She gave one. She gave a very loud last thought. She was like, Trees and Tutus, love it.
Love it.